three, four. Welcome to Fender Play Live. I'm your host this week, Eugene Edwards. Now, whether you're recording music, covering a song, or starting to play with others, one of the most important parts of guitar is learning to find where your voice fits in, or how to find your lane, as we say. So today we're going to talk about building guitar arrangements. And stick around, too, because we'll be announcing the winner of the gear giveaway this week. But first, please welcome my guests, Eleanor Whitmore and Chris Masterson, collectively known as the Mastersons. I don't think we really planned it this way, but since it's our Valentine's Week show, we've got a husband and wife musician team. They both play in Steve Earle's band, The Dukes, among many other projects, and they're also going to be releasing some new music of their own under the Mastersons banner. Mentioning The Dukes, though, we want to mention the man in the picture here in the frame. Would you guys tell us who this is?
That's Kelly Looney, longtime bassist for Steve Earle. He was with Steve for 31 years, and he just passed away in November. It's kind of sudden, and so we're remembering him.
We're going to dedicate this episode to Kelly. In fact, I remember the last time I saw him was your birthday, and he'd made the cake.
Yeah. Oh, that's right. Well, last summer we all toured together.
And it was,
It was Steve Earle and Dwight Yoakam and Lucinda Williams. And so, you know, a lot of times on these shows, there's a lot of waiting, so we all hang out.
Right.
Eat and...
Yeah, we do eat. And we talk about tunes. And we talk about the things we're going to be discussing today. Now, let's talk a little bit about the gear that you're seeing. And we're going to start off with the show stealer, clearly. What do you have over here, Eleanor?
This is a Fender Tele Tenor.
Mm-hmm. And I got to say, this is a pretty unique finish, we must admit.
Yes, it is that's customized a color.
I'm officially jealous.
Just for me.
And it is. And that's right. And so what's your relationship with the tenor guitar? You've been playing it for a while.
Yeah, I am a fiddle player. That's my main instrument. And just, you know, working in different ensembles, the fiddle is not always appropriate. So I was always looking for other voices. Mm-hmm. Started out playing the mandolin. And then just kind of wanted to have a deeper range, which is why I picked up the tenor guitar. And it kind of came about in the 20s, helping banjo players transition over to guitar.
I guess that makes it. And then how do you tune yours?
I tune mine, C is the low string, G, D, A. And so all the chord shapes are kind of mandolin chord shapes.
And as a violin player, you probably think
think in fifths. If I'm in a solo, I need it to be tuned in fifths.
You think in fourths, but yes. You think in fifths. That's very smart. So check out any of the Fender videos on the tenor telly. Can you play a little bit of it so we can hear it on its own?
Yeah, sure.
In the moment it's in a mix, it really stands out. So that could be in a band with two guitars, then you add something like that, it's going to poke, right?
You get examples of that, exactly. Yeah. And Chris, and we've seen this guitar on this show before.
Oh yeah, that my 58 Tele.
I think I get to play this later on,
yeah.
This guitar. How did you guys meet up, and how long have you been playing together, just the general?
Well, we met, it's 15 years now or so. We met at a festival in Colorado and started playing music together and then started hanging out, not on stage together, and we've been pretty inseparable ever since.
Yeah.
It all happened really quick.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. And and you guys usually do a lot of shows as a duo, which I know I've seen you guys do that. So, but you also, when you do your albums, you're doing this full band arrangement.
Yeah, and we do some band stuff on the road. So it's a hodgepodge, but that kind of ties in with our lesson today because you're constantly having to reevaluate how you play. Like in a duo, you might just be making as much noise as you can.
Could be making as much volume as you can.
But then in a bigger ensemble, you know, if you have a rhythm section, if you have a keyboard player, if you have horns, you know, you're going to make your part a lot skinnier. You're going to find your lane within a bigger ensemble, which is,
So talking about that, so we're looking at this very important aspect, but often forgot aspect of guitar playing, which is how to arrange guitar parts. And we're going to dig into what that means soon, but it's a key element of playing with other people, recording music when you're songwriting. As always, if you have any questions for myself or for the Mastersons, drop them in the comments and we'll try to answer them while we're live on air. Now, we're going to break down some songs that you can learn today on Fender Play and show you how arrangements can really add a lot to them. So first off, we're going to start with Stepping Stone by the Monkees, which is on Fender Play. And this pretty much has the same chords over again. It's a E, G, A, and C. So, and if we were all kind of in a garage band, we would all kind of just play those chords. You just naturally go, it's this and this and this, and we would all play the same thing, and it would sound like this. We're like, 2, 3, 4. It's kind of muddy and it's kind of, so, but we've come up with individual parts. Like I will just be playing the regular part that you just heard, but they're going to do something differently. Now on the record, there's a keyboard. And so I think Eleanor, you've kind of got a part that kind of emulates that. Can we just hear that on its own?
Sure.
That part?
Well, we can do the melody part or
Meanwhile, Chris will be doing something.
And I'll take something almost like the melody, just.
Right. So here's how it sounds when it's all put together. Here, 2, 3, 4. Get your dynamics. And back to your parts for the chorus.
I'm not just stepping stone.
So we got three different parts kind of coming there and kind of spreading it out when you're a string band, right? We don't have drums and bass and all, and or horns or.
Yeah, but and I think it's just about listening to what's there. You know, it's the first step is listening. Like what's being covered.
We're talking about sometimes if you're asked to sit in with a band and you go up there and you've never played a song with the band, but you know the song, you got to listen first. Or I'll just look at the guitar player's hands and see where he is, and I'll make sure I'm not in the same neighborhood.
Yeah, and it's knowing your fretboard, find a different inversion or.
Right. And remember we were talking about Chess records.
Yeah, well I remember listening to like you know things like Muddy Waters and Howlin' Wolf mm-hmm. and Little Walter. And there's always two guitar players. There might be one doing like a low part. But then there's always someone, you know, instead of the other guitar player doing that, you might be up here.
So just
and
just
that way, there's you know, everybody has their own lane.
Right, exactly. I'm holding down the fort. He's having fun up top. What are guitar arrangements? So that's a good example of that. Of course, if you listen to, there's lots of Beatles songs because you had this classic two guitar setup where usually John was strumming chords in the early days, and George had the kind of a particular part where he was kind of pointing something out. I know, being that I play with Dwight Yoakam, and studying those records, I noticed that there was this very common role that the two guitars played. Dwight would be strumming the big cowboy chords on his Martin acoustic, and Pete Anderson would be playing these very spiky singular lines, and Pete would never strum the chords along with Dwight. They had their own lines. It was very, very, of course, we talked about Bakersfield stuff all the time whenever I'm here, but Buck Owens and Don Rich.
Right.
You know, Buck would be strumming on an acoustic, usually capoed somewhere, giving different voicings, while Don Rich would just kind of wait and choose his spot to give you, while Buck's just kind of.
Like we talked about B.B. King, who never played chords.
Right, so yeah,
the
right.
Ensemble,
the horns would be kind of like in B flat. The horns would be.
I mean.
There you go, yeah. He found his lane and he was
right.
Beautifully, you know. And, so without arrangements, like you heard the garage version of the Monkees tune, you've got instruments will be conflicting and kind of muddying it all up, but then we kind of spread it out. So it's really important to distinguish yourself from the other guitar parts when you have multiple guitar parts. We're going to move to one of our favorite parts here, which is the trivia. So we've got a question here. We'd like to throw some trivia to the audience and we'd like to test your skills. So drop your answer in the comments, and the first person to answer correctly gets a shout out. Now this one, I have to admit, I didn't know the answer to this one. This is a great, great question. Eleanor, you asked the question.
Okay. Legendary Beatles arranger George Martin took oboe lessons from the mother of which famous actress?
Wow.
Yeah, I know.
Deep cuts.
Yeah, exactly. So you mentioned Lucinda Williams earlier, because we did the LSD tour last summer. And she, a couple of times on that tour, she did a song that I absolutely love. So we're going to do this for Lucinda, and Eleanor is going to sing it. And just kind of watch and see what each of us is playing. We're going to spread these parts out. I, for one, am going to emulate. Since we don't have a drummer, I'm going to kind of emphasize on the backbeat on this acoustasonic, which is set up for just like a plain acoustic sound. And of course, you've got some.
I'll grab the 12.
Why not?
Lick, because this beautiful electric 12 is sitting right here,
and it's 12.
A classic lick. And then what are you going to do?
Yeah, I'm going to play some tenor telly.
Okay.
All right.
You start off.
Two, three.
Example, I'm doing this kind of this Batman, emphasizing the two and the four of the measure rhythmically. You kind of just a whole
yeah,
note.
Just some whole note diamonds.
Diamonds, as we call them. Just kind of letting that sustain out there. And then, Chris, you're filling in the middle.
Yeah. And that was, that 12 string probably, you think Beatles or birds,
Right. That's another interesting way to make your guitar arrangements interesting. If you have access to different types of guitars and different types of stringed instruments, that's another good way. The tenor telly obviously sits in a different range.
Right. Like two of the same might, two of the same might actually sound smaller. If you find a less busy part in a different instrument, your part's going to stand out.
And you don't even have to have a tenor telly. You could just take a capo and put it up there, and that's automatically take your regularly tuned guitar and put you in a new neighborhood,
Yeah.
So let's see. We've got a winner already.
Wow.
These people. I'll tell you what.
All right.
Okay, Eleanor, you want to tell them let me re-ask the question. That's right. Legendary Beatles arranger George Martin took oboe lessons from the mother of which famous actress? Okay, now Eleanor, to help.
Colin Bunner answered correctly, and it was Jane Asher.
Jane Asher, who dated Paul McCartney for a minute.
Wow.
Jane Asher, the subject of many, many great Beatles songs, actually, when Paul was dating her. Now, we're going to take a quick break here, but when we come back, we're going to play some more and hear a special performance by the Mastersons. But first, another important element to guitar arrangements is the sound coming from your amp. And it's no secret that we're country fans. So today, we're going to take a look at some easy ways to get a good country tone from your amp.
Hi there, my name is Rick Hines. I'm the product development manager for amplifiers. I've been at Fender a long time. I love all different styles of music, and I get a lot of questions from guitarists on how to get specific tones. Now, I'm a big fan of country music, and one of the questions that comes about is, how do I get my favorite country tone? So a lot of players, when they get to country, the most important guitar, and has been for a very long time, is the Telecaster. Now I happen to have with me one of the American Performer Telecasters. This one's in penny. So I've got a couple of different amplifiers with me today. I have the 68 Custom, which is an all-tube amplifier. And I also have a Mustang GT100, and that's a digital amplifier. The EQ on the 68 Custom is very simple, but in general, I like to make sure that the amp's on the bright side. So I set the treble at about 6 or if not higher, and the bass at about 4 or so. So I'm gonna crank up the guitar. Let's see how that sounds. So there's the basic tone that I like to use, kind of my canvas. So I brought with me 3 different pedals. I brought a compressor, I brought an overdrive, and I brought a delay. And I'll explain how to use each one of these in that style of music. A lot of guitarists don't understand exactly how compression works, but the idea is simple. What it does is it takes the loud notes and it makes them quieter, and it takes the quieter notes and it makes them louder, so it gives you a very even sound. So with the compressor, I've set it so that the compression is pretty extreme, so notes get really squishy and twangy sounding. The other effect a lot of guitarists like to use in country is a little bit of overdrive. Now I realize that country generally has a cleaner sound, but sometimes for solos or certain parts, having just a little bit of overdrive really helps. The last effect I'm going to add to this is delay. Now I'm not going to set the delay for very long. I'm going to have a bit of a slapback. So with the delay, I'm going to set it so that the repeat's only 1 or 2, and the delay is very quick. All right, I'm engaging all 3 pedals now. Okay, let's now check out the Mustang GT100. The amp model that I'm gonna use in the Mustang GT100 is the 65 Deluxe. This amplifier replicates the tone stack and the gain and everything else that a tube amp does. So when I set it, it'll be very similar to the 68. This is the bass tone that you're gonna have. Alright, so that's the bass tone. So like the 68 Custom, instead of adding effects pedals in the front of it, the Mustang actually has the effects built in. So what I'm going to do is replicate the sound that I was talking about previously by adding overdrive, by adding compression, and by adding delay. So when I go into the Mustang and I select the effects, what I did is I went to the green box, which is based on a classic overdrive sound. With the compressor, I went to high compression because I wanted that similar effect of really squeezing the notes. And for the delay, I'm going to use the mono tape delay, which is going to replicate a classic tape echo. I'm going to set it very fast, and I'm going to have very few repeats, just like the delay I used for the 68 Custom. Let's see how that sounds. All right, so that's the Mustang GT100. Either one's a great option to get that classic Fender twang. Remember, these settings are just my personal taste. You can set them however you like, whatever sounds best to you. For more information, go to Fender.com and stay tuned here for more videos.
And we're back. Thank you, Rick. Thank you for coming from the Tone Zone and for those great tips. I'm here, of course, I'm here with the Mastersons. And I just realized that with the 3 of us, it looks like we're doing a personal tribute to Neapolitan ice cream. So we've defined what guitar arrangements are and why they're a crucial part of songwriting and recording. But let's play another song. This is one of my favorite bands, The Kinks. This song is also available on Fender Play. We're going to break down how to go about arranging guitar, and we're going to show you guys some fun and easy tips again. Now, I'm just going to strum the acoustic part as Ray Davies did on the record. Again, this song also has an organ part, and so we're going to kind of cover that somehow.
Eleanor will go up there.
On the tenor telly. And by the way, it's not a bass just because it has 4 strings. It's a guitar, but it sits in a higher range, the tenor range. And Chris, what are you going to do here on your magnificent telly?
I'll just kind of listen. You know, what I would do in that instance where all the mids are sort of covered,
here,
I would start to just find out. I'd start to figure out what can I do, you know, with a you know, the low end.
And how do you get that sound from your guitar?
Well, and that's maybe, you know, that's another thing in a multiplayer ensemble. If someone else is on their bridge pickup with a lot of gain, I might go to my neck pickup and go for a clean tone.
And get a little more.
And just find a way, find my lane sonically as much as the part.
Right. In terms of the EQ spectrum.
So the way I see it is we have the acoustic covered, and then we have the top end covered. So then that's, you know. Where do I go? Where's my lane?
You got it. Okay, so here we go. Here's a Sunny Afternoon by the Kinks. Here's our attempt at it. Start us up.
1, 2, 3, 4.
Afternoon as interpreted by the Neapolitan Trio. Yeah. Now, so we talked about a really fun and easy way to arrange guitar parts is to make sure you're switching up the type of guitar and getting different tones, different type of instrument. Different guitars bring different voices. There's 12 strings, which is obviously going to sound different than the 6th string. We've got something like a tenor telly, which is in a different range. Acoustics versus electric. Even if it's two electric guitars in a band and you've got one guy who's got a guitar with humbuckers, maybe it makes sense to get something.
Sometimes it's a single coil.
Single coils and just spread it out. And you'll see that that dynamic play out a lot when you watch Tom Petty and the Heartbreakers. Pearl Jam's another great example.
Or the Stones or Aerosmith.
Stones, yeah.
You can think of a lot of the two guitar bands, mm-hmm. and each player really has his or her own character.
Right, they find their lane.
Yeah.
So now, I've been looking forward to this. We're very lucky today because Chris and Eleanor are going to, they're pros at arranging music, clearly. And they have a brand new album that's coming out soon. And this is a chance to hear them. I think I give this to you.
I give this to you.
Okay, I take
not to
this.
Keep. Oh, here. Sorry, bud.
Missed my chance. And we're going to do a song from their new album. And how did the song come about? Yeah, this is...
So when we started writing this song, it kind of just started out with your basic cowboy chords. Which is pretty boring.
But it'll suffice when you're writing lyrics.
Yeah.
Yeah, it gives you a template. It gives you a
better... But if you had a whole record of that, that would be,
It's a little samey.
Like the coffee house, I guess.
Yeah.
But, so the moment you pick up another instrument or you find another muse in something, you know, we take those same four chords... And, you know, grab a 12 string, like the Fender Electric 12.
For instance.
And, you know, where we go right over to Laurel Canyon. Mm-hmm.
Step out on the shelf. open wide.
Heard the Mastersons. I don't know what to tell you. So now that's a song. Eyes Wide Open is
Eyes from, Open Wide.
Eyes Open
right
Wide.
The first time.
From the new album called
No Time for Love Songs.
No Time for Love Songs.
Yes, it's ironically a love song, but.
Okay. So and when does this album come out?
The record comes out March 6th.
March 6th. Okay. Okay. Soon. And then and where did you guys record it?
And we made it right around the corner at Sunset Sound here in Hollywood. And we made it with Shooter Jennings producing. And we all worked together at the start of 2019 on Tanya Tucker's record, While I'm Living, with Ian Brandy Carlisle. And it was then, you know, we had the songs banging around, but it was kind of then when we were reminded of how great Shooter was in the studio as a producer, as a piano player. Yeah. And so we just decided to do it that way.
How fun. How fun. And do you guys know, how can people find out about you guys in terms of getting the record or when they can, where they can see you live?
The mastersonsmusic.com. We've got all of our tour dates up and how to find the record and all that. So.
And you can find us on Instagram as the Mastersons and Twitter and all those usual things. And
fantastic.
Our personal Instagram pages are where the gear pictures usually are and stuff.
Ah, yes.
All that fun stuff.
It's a lot of cool gear.
Yeah.
Yes, their apartment is very well appointed with gear.
It looked like there was a question can a uke player tune a tenor telly to play like a uke? That is a great question.
Might need a different string gauge for the low string, right?
I think you're going to have to get some different string gauges. I'm not sure about that.
You could probably, I would guess the answer would be yes.
Yes, it's
possible. It would
require
a little setup.
It's possible.
A little bit of setup work, because different string gauge may have an effect on the neck, but yeah, it's absolutely possible. Yeah,
cool.
That's a great question. That's a great question. Now, every week, we like to assign homework to our viewing community, and especially to those in our Fender Play community of learners. For those in our community, make sure you post your homework so we can help you out. Now, the homework coming out of this episode, the beginner level is that you want to play the chords to Drunken Angel by Lucinda Williams. That song is on Fender Play. So beginner level, play the chords to Drunken Angel.
So intermediate, take a listen to the 12th the 12 string part on the song, the arpeggiated part, and see if you can learn that.
And then Chris, what's the advanced?
Well, for the advanced, find an element in the recording that might not be a guitar, whether it be an organ or some other part, and try and come up with an arrangement with that on your instrument, because we don't always have the luxury of having these big bands.
No, I remember years ago, I saw Danny Gatton did a clinic, and he talked about how being in bands, and there wouldn't be like a B3 player, and he learned how to play B3 parts on a tele.
Absolutely.
Front pickup, some vibrato on the amp, kind of get some grit, and then the way you voice things differently.
Absolutely.
So that's a great solution. So yeah, you can take the guitar and let it interpret other instruments, find a piano part or something like that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Or horn parts is great too.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the thing about Chuck Berry, really, was that he was able to emulate somehow like jump blues band horn parts, but on a guitar.
Absolutely.
He's trying to do Louis Jordan tunes.
And the player that figures out how to do that in an ensemble situation is indispensable. You'll always have work if you can get on a stage or a studio and find your lane.
That's a great point. In fact, I love this word indispensable, because this episode would have been indispensable without you guys. Eleanor and Chris, thank you so much
for
coming
over.
Thanks for having us.
And so thank you. Now we're going to have Dylan slide over. We're going to bring on our community guru, Dylan, who's going to tell us what's new on the Fender Play site in the community. And most importantly, who is winning some gear this week. Welcome, Dylan.
Ah, yes, welcome. That was fantastic. I'm still a little, verklempt from that, to be honest. But I'll try to compose myself. Talk amongst yourself.
I'm going to cry myself to sleep.
Well,
I'm sorry. So let's get to the giveaway. I'm sorry.
Sounds good.
Every week on Fender Play Live, we give away a free piece of gear to a Fender Play subscriber just for hitting their weekly practice streak. So to hit your streak, all you need to do is practice 3 times a week for 7 minutes each time, and that qualifies you for the Fender Play giveaway. Dylan, tell us what they can win.
Well, the lucky winner gets to choose from a list of Strats, Teles, Jazzmasters, Basses, Amps, and that's all just for practicing. The best part is, the more consecutive streaks you hit, the more chances you have to win. So it's about 21
sense.
Minutes a week, and the more streaks you hit, the more you can win. It sounds pretty darn cool to me.
It's very doable.
That's right. You can make it happen.
Okay. And it's announced right here on Fender Play Live. So without further ado, Dylan, who's this week's lucky winner?
Let's get it going.
Here we go.
Weston H. Weston H.
Weston H. Good name.
All right. Woo.
Congratulations, Weston. You just won something.
All right. Congratulations, Weston. Way to go. So for more info on how you can win the giveaway, check the link in the description.
That's right.
And as we've mentioned, we have an awesome and ever-growing community of learners. Dylan, tell us more about that.
Yeah. So for anybody that doesn't know, the Fender Play community is basically a community online that you can get access to once you become a member of Fender Play. It's a group where we basically get together and you can access instructors like myself or many other instructors just like Eugene here. And we help each other kind of get through the process of learning, as well as augment what's on the site. So when you have questions, you can ask us questions, you can ask each other questions, you can commiserate, and you can celebrate. So you got a lot of options there. But there's a couple people that we pick out every week to sort of say like holler to. And I want to say Ivan Belvins, who's somebody that's like a really important community member. He posted his homework from last week. We had a 80s pop rock episode last week, and I think he played some Cars, Duran Duran. He's a fantastic community member, and I hope you're watching tonight, Ivan, because if you are...
Hi, Ivan!
There you go. All right, and then Kelsey Gard is a brand new member. Mm-hmm. I think she's on Rock Level 2. This is her first post, her first video post with her brand new Fender Strat.
Nice. Mm-hmm.
And she did an excellent job. So, we're super proud of you. Her fret hand looks amazing, was the thing I wanted to say.
Okay.
So congratulations for an amazing fret hand.
Congratulations on your hand.
Indubitably. Yes.
And every week we're adding new songs and skills to the site, so there's always something new for you to learn. Just this month we've added songs from Muse, The Beatles, Radiohead, Chris Stapleton, and tons more. Dylan, what's new this week?
Ah, well, I'm glad you asked. So there's a lot of new songs, but I'm just going to talk about 3 of them. So the first one, I'll just start playing this. Do an arrangement.
That's
since
we're very cool.
Right?
That was really cool.
So if you didn't know, that there was Love Roller Coaster by the Ohio Players.
Very good.
I was going to do sort of like a swing version, but our producer said, absolutely not. So anyway, maybe next time. See me after hours.
Sounds like an anti-producer.
Yeah, yeah. one of the other songs we have coming, let's see, you could do a fingerstyle arrangement, would be like. Poorly representing it, but yeah, I mean, that's a great song. That's like a must. That's kind of a like a must.
Fantastic
repertoire. And we have a lot of stuff on the site. If you're interested in solo guitar playing, kind of like what I was showing you, check out bass note strum, check out double stops, check out switching strings during bass note strum. Like, there's a ton of stuff that's on there where we do outline how you can do these exact techniques and make your own. In case you don't have the Neapolitan crew with you. We don't need them. No, you can still do your own version, though. So that's the good news. So check it out. Another song that's coming out is How to Save a Life by The Fray.
Okay.
I didn't want to take it there because if I go to that place, I'm not sure I can come back.
Come on.
I don't know. I can't.
Are you sure, really?
No, it's just.
Come on, please. You're making me beg. You're making me beg. Don't make me beg you.
That's all I can do.
That's how to save my life. Dylan, thank you so much.
Thank you.
And a huge thank you to the Mastersons for stopping by. Yeah. Another round of applause.
Oh,
those are my favorite people. I don't get to spend as much time with them as I'd like, so I was really, really happy that they were able to be here with us today. Now, also, join us next week for another episode. I'm your host, Eugene Edwards. Keep practicing, and see you next time. And Dylan, will you play a G chord with me, please?
I will.
Thank you. Ready?
Ha-ha!